Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now, here is Pastor Dennis Murray.
Good day to you. God bless you. Welcome to Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. Ready to get back into our Father's Word today. We're going to pick it up in 1 Kings chapter 21, verse 1, as we get back into this beautiful book of Kings. In our last lecture, we saw God delivered Ben-Hadad in the Syrian army into the hands of Ahab and the armies of Israel, not once, but twice. And Ahab messed up after Ben-Hadad had sent message to Ahab that before the first battles took place, all your gold is mine, all your silver is mine, your wives are mine, and your children are mine. In other words, everything that you own and take pride in and value, I'm laying claim to it. Well, Ahab finally got some backbone about him. Well, God sent a prophet to him and promised him the victory. I don't know that Ahab would even have believed the prophet of the Lord, but the prophet of the Lord was correct, and he had the victory. Then the second time, when God warned Ahab, in the spring of next year, you take guard, the Syrians are going to be back. And sure enough, they came back, and Israel was victorious once again. This time, Ben-Hadad went and hid for fear of his life. But then he sent ambassadors to Ahab and kind of flattered him a little bit with sweet words. And Ahab, being the fool that he was, made a pact, an allegiance, a covenant with Ben-Hadad, the king of Syria, and invited him up into his own chariot. Well, God wasn't happy with that, and he sent a prophet and Ahab basically passed his own sentence, and that is that he would die. What happens in chapter 21, I think, is part of the reason that God chose to exterminate the not only Ahab, but his children, and also Jezebel. And we come to chapter 21, verse 1, we see Ahab and Jezebel at it again, chapter 21, concerning Naboth and his vineyard. Let's go with verse 1. We ask that word of wisdom in Yeshua's precious name. Father, I'll ask you to open eyes, open ears. Chapter 21, verse 1, and it reads, "And it came to pass after these things that Naboth the Jezreelite had a vineyard which was in Jezreel, hard by the palace of Ahab, king of Samaria." Hard by meaning it was near. It was the property adjacent to the property that Ahab had in Jezreel. Jezreel was the location. It's thought that Ahab probably had a summer home there. That when Elijah performed the miracles up on Carmel and the rain was finally going to come, you remember the Lord strengthened Elijah, and Elijah ran in front of Ahab's chariot all the way from Carmel to Jezreel. And how do you think Ahab and Jezebel would be to have for neighbors? Well, let's find out. Chapter 2, verse 2, I should say. "And Ahab spake unto Naboth, saying, Give me thy vineyard, that I may have it for a garden of herbs," a vegetable garden, if you will, "because it is near unto my house, and I will give thee for it a better vineyard than it. Or if it seem good to thee, I will give thee the worth of it in money." At least Ahab is offering to reimburse Naboth for the vineyard. But you see, you can't sell your inheritance. when Israel moved into the promised land, the land was divided into allotments. Each tribe had a certain amount of land depending on how many people were in the tribe, and then it was divided by lot into families. And your inheritance was yours forever. That was God's original intent. Unfortunately, that changed when Israel decided to disobey God. But you couldn't sell your own vineyard. And what we're seeing here too is a fulfillment of 1 Samuel chapter 8, verse 14, when Israel sought a man king. And God said, well, you want a man king, I'll let you have one, but here's what a man king will do. He'll take your sons and your daughters and put them to work for him. He'll put your sons in the military. He'll take the best of your vineyards and your olive yards for himself or his servants. So we see 1 Samuel 8:14 being fulfilled. You know, and spiritually, we can take this, what is your inheritance today? Spiritually, your inheritance is the kingdom of God. Don't be like Esau was, who was willing to trade his inheritance for a red bowl of pottage, a bowl of red pottage. And that aggravated God. It made God very angry. That's why God would say later, Jacob I loved, Esau I hated. Part of the reason God hated Esau was that he didn't value his inheritance. Don't allow anyone to take your place in the kingdom. Verse 3, and Naboth said to Ahab, the Lord forbid it me that I should give or sell the inheritance of my fathers unto thee. Naboth respected the law of Leviticus chapter 25, verse 23, Numbers chapter 36, verses 7 and 8. Ahab, on the other hand, is breaking one of the Ten Commandments. The last of the Ten Commandments is, thou shalt not covet your neighbor's property, his wife or his home or his land or his vineyard. Ahab is coveting Naboth's vineyard. Verse 4, and Ahab came into his house heavy and displeased because of the word which Naboth the Jezreelite had spoken to him. For he had said, I will not give thee the inheritance of my fathers. And he, this is Ahab, laid him down upon his bed and turned away his face and would eat no bread. And this is what this means, is he turned his face toward the wall. Not only did he not want to talk to anyone, he didn't want to see anyone. He was heavy and displeased. That means he was sad and angry. But at least he was willing to let it go at that. Jezebel won't. He's acting like a child here. He's throwing a pouty little fit is what he's doing. At least he didn't force the issue. Jezebel will. Verse 5. But Jezebel, his wife, came to him and said unto him, why is thy spirit so sad that thou eatest no bread? And she's saying, I know something is wrong. Tell me what it is, Pooh Bear. That was Jezebel's nickname for Ahab, was Pooh Bear. Verse 6. And he said unto her, because I spake unto Naboth the Jezreelite, and I said unto him, give me thy vineyard for money, or else, if it please thee, I will give thee another vineyard for it. And he answered, I will not give thee my vineyard. And Jezebel no doubt starts seeing red. I will not, Naboth saying, though, I will not dishonor God by giving up my inheritance in the land. Verse 7. And Jezebel, his wife, said unto him, dost thou now govern the kingdom of Israel? In other words, are you the king or not? Arise and eat bread, and let thine heart be merry. I will give thee the vineyard of Naboth, the Jezreelite. Well, you see, it wasn't Jezebel's to give legally, but that won't stop Jezebel. She'll give it to Ahab illegally, verse 8. So she wrote letters in Ahab's name. She forged the letters and sealed them with his seal and sent the letters unto the elders and to the nobles that were in his city dwelling with Naboth. Jezebel is setting up Naboth. The king's seal, of course, at this time when someone wrote a letter, they would take a single piece of paper, write the letter, and then fold the letter over three times, and then take some hot wax and place it where the pieces of paper met, and then took the person's ring signet, which were a signature in other words, and stamped it in the hot wax. And anyone who saw the seal of King Ahab would think that this was a letter from him. And again, she's forging this, but the people of Jezreel are going to think it's from Ahab. Verse 9. And she wrote in the letter, saying this to the elders of Jezreel, proclaim a fast and set Naboth on high among the people. And this is bad news to proclaim a fast. This was a sign of some public crime or some heavy load of guilt that had been placed on Jezreel. And you know, Jezreel was not a metropolis by any means. It was a rural area. And I'm certain that most everyone that knew everyone in the community. And these elders are probably looking at each other like, I didn't do anything. Did you do anything? No, I didn't do anything. And they're all, I'm sure, curious. But Naboth being placed on high means that he's placed in a conspicuous place. And this all happening in the gate of the town, which is where the place of judgment or court would be held. Naboth is the accused, verse 10. The letter from Jezebel to the elders continues. And set two men, sons of Belial, before him. Belial meaning worthless or lawless men. To bear witness against him, to bear false witness against him, saying, thou didst blaspheme God and the king. This word blaspheme is barak in the Hebrew, and it's to bless, but by euphemism, it's to curse God or the king. And Jezebel is accusing Naboth of cursing both God and the king. Verse 10 continuing, and then carry him out and stone him that he may die. Boy, what a nice lady is Jezebel. Jezebel was a real sweet lady. She was getting the vineyard for Ahab, and it didn't matter that innocent blood was going to be spilled to accomplish her will. Verse 11. And the men of his city, even the elders and the nobles who were the inhabitants in his city, Jezreel, did as Jezebel had sent unto them, and as it was written in the letters which she had sent to them. And this, the fact that they didn't stand up to Jezebel is a proof of how deeply corrupt and how the morals of the nation had gone down in fear of Jezebel. They didn't fight it at all. They're going along with Jezebel's wishes. And of course, remember, they think it's the king Ahab who put these orders out. You don't do what the king commands, you're likely to lose your head. Verse 12. They proclaimed a fast, just as Jezebel had ordered, and set Naboth on high among the people. Now, they're probably thinking, you know, this is a kangaroo sham trial anyway. Let's get this over with. Again, Naboth is the accused. And there came in two men, children of Belial, and sat before him. And the men of Belial witnessed against him. They lied, even against Naboth in the presence of the people, saying, Naboth did blaspheme Barak to curse God or the king, to blaspheme God and the king. Then they carried him forth out of the city and stoned him with stones that he died. And you know, this I couldn't help but think about the blood of righteous Abel, who was murdered by his brother. Abel was innocent. He hadn't done anything. The only problem with Cain was with Abel was that God accepted Abel's sacrifice or offerings to him, and he didn't accept or appreciate Cain's. Cain killed his brother, murdered his brother in a fit of jealousy, and the blood of righteous Abel was crying out to God from the ground, and God heard. You better believe the blood of righteous Naboth is crying out to the Lord from the ground, and it's going to be heard again. It's written in 2 Kings chapter 9, verse 26, that Naboth's sons were also stoned to death and killed. You see, the land belonged to the family, and had Jezebel just had Naboth killed, but the sons were still surviving, the land would have been theirs, not Ahab's. So not only did Jezebel take care of Naboth, she took care of his descendants as well. Verse 14, and they sent to Jezebel saying, Naboth is stoned and is dead. Your mission of deceit and murder carried out. Verse 15, and it came to pass when Jezebel heard that Naboth was stoned and was dead, that Jezebel said to Ahab, arise, take possession of the vineyard of Naboth, the Jezreelite. This is good news, Pooh Bear. That's her nickname for Ahab, which he refused to give thee for money, for Naboth is not alive, but dead. Now you can plant your vegetable garden real close to the house, honey. Everything is okay now. Not, verse 16. And it came to pass, when Ahab heard that Naboth was dead, that Ahab rose up to go down to the vineyard of Naboth, the Jezreelite, and take possession of it. Naboth's sons are dead. Is Ahab innocent in all of this? You know, he didn't force the issue. Yes, he's not innocent. He's guilty in this. He's guilty, number one, of breaking the commandment, thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's property. Well, both of Ahab and Jezebel are going to pay for this one. Elijah is going to be bringing the bad news to them. Verse 17. And the word of the Lord came to Elijah the Tishbite, saying, arise, go down to meet Ahab, king of Israel. This is the Lord speaking to Elijah, which is in Samaria, the capital of the 10 northern tribes. Behold, he is in the vineyard of Naboth, whither he has gone down to possess it. And this proves the omnipotence of our Heavenly Father. You see that the blood of righteous Naboth and his sons was crying out to our Lord from the ground. He heard, and he's going to send Elijah to tell Ahab what the judgment of God is on Ahab and Jezebel. Verse 19, and thou shalt speak unto him, saying, thus saith the Lord, hast thou killed, this is ratsak in the Hebrew, and it's used especially of murder, and also taken possession, question, And thou shalt speak unto him, saying, Thus saith the Lord, In the place where dogs lick the blood of Naboth, shall dogs lick thy blood, even thine. In Ahab's case, this would happen in the streets of Samaria, chapter 22, verse 38, when we get there. But Ahab's blood, not his own blood from his own body, but his blood from his son, Joram, when they recovered the corpse of Joram after the Syrian war, they took his corpse and threw it in the vineyard of Naboth. The dogs came and licked up the blood of Joram, which was Ahab's blood, because Joram was Ahab's son. Verse 20. And Ahab said to Elijah, Hast thou found me, O mine enemy? And he answered, I have found thee, because thou hast sold thyself to work evil in the sight of the Lord. And this means you've become a slave to doing evil. This is almost like selling your soul to the devil in the language that we use today. But Ahab called Elijah, O mine enemy. You never have liked me, Elijah. If you had, you would have prophesied good unto me. In this we see how very little the Carmel, the miracles that were performed there, had on Ahab. Verse 21. Behold, I will bring evil upon thee, and will take away thy posterity, thy your seed, your children, in other words, and will cut off from Ahab him that pisseth against the wall. That's a figure of speech meaning every male, and him that is shut up and left in Israel. This is another figure of speech meaning he that is in a strengthened or fortified place. And I don't care how strengthened and fortified your hiding place is, it's not good enough to hide from your heavenly Father. There is no place to hide from him. Verse 22. And will make thine house like the house or the family of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, the first man king of the 10 tribes after the split of the nation. And like the house of Baasha, the son of Ahiah, the third man king of the 10 northern tribes. For the provocation wherewith thou hast provoked me to anger and made Israel to sin. It's not bad enough that you sinned yourself, but you led your entire nation to sin as well. As the leader of a nation goes, usually so goes the nation. 23. And of Jezebel also spake the Lord, saying, The dog shall eat Jezebel by the wall of Jezreel. And that also came to pass. No decent burial for Jezebel. This came to pass in 2 Kings chapter 9, verse 30, and the following verses. 24. Him that dieth of Ahab, in other words, of Ahab's family, in the city the dog shall eat, and him that dieth in the field shall the fowls of the air eat. And this is the curse of Deuteronomy 28:26. If you don't do things God's way, you won't even have a decent burial. Your body will be left in the city for the dogs to eat. If you die outside of the city, the birds of the air will eat your flesh. 25. But there was none like unto Ahab. Out of 20 kings of Israel, he is arguably the worst, which did sell himself to work wickedness in the sight of the Lord, whom Jezebel his wife stirred up. Ahab was pretty much a wet noodle. He didn't have any backbone whatsoever, and that was witnessed by our early chapters. But Jezebel had a way of inciting him. And remember, where was Jezebel from? Was she of the tribes of Israel? No, she was of Zidon. Her father was a Baal priest. So she taught Ahab and influenced Ahab into heathenistic ways. 26, and he did very abominably in following idols, according to all things, as did the Amorites, whom the Lord cast out before the children of Israel. The Amorites, one of the seven Canaanites, that's with the sea tribes that inhabited the promised land before God gave it to Israel. In other words, Ahab was as bad as the heathenistic Canaanites. 27, and it came to pass when Ahab heard those words, the words of Elijah, that he rent his clothes and put sackcloth upon his flesh and fasted and lay in sackcloth and went softly. He went humbly, and he did sincerely humble himself. He genuinely is repentant, as we'll see, because of God's reaction. And God, you can't con God. God knows your heart and he knows your mind. And in verse 28, and the word of the Lord came to Elijah the Tishbite, saying, and if you think you've done something so bad that you cannot be forgiven, don't ever forget this scripture. Ahab being probably one of the worst of the 20 kings of the 10 northern tribes of Israel, repented and humbled himself, and the Lord heard. It's not possible at this point in time that anyone has committed the unforgivable sin. There is an unforgivable sin. That's when God's elect are delivered up before the Antichrist, and if they refuse the Holy Spirit, that is unforgivable. At this point in time, anything is forgivable. Verse 29, seest thou how Ahab humbleth himself before me? Because he humbleth himself before me, I will not bring the evil in his days, but in his son's days will I bring the evil upon his house. And we truly have a God of that is full of grace. As it's written in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, that it's not his will that any should perish, but that all would come to repentance. And even Ahab, in his heart, did come to repentance. And, you know, this might seem to some as though God favored Ahab by not bringing the calamity that he promised upon his house while he was yet living, but on his children. And it would seem that his sons are paying for the sins of Ahab. Well, in Exodus chapter 20, verse 4, it states in one of the commandments, the second commandment, thou shalt have no graven images and bow down and worship them. And he said the sins of the will carry down to the third and fourth generation to those who hate me, but I will show mercy or love to those who love me. And so Ahab's son Joram is no better than Ahab, and he continued to practice the sins of Ahab, is the reason that God would do this. Chapter 22, Ahab seeks an ally against the king of Syria. You remember in our earlier chapters, it was prophesied that the Syrians would come in 3 years. Well, it's getting close to that time, and Ahab is seeking an ally. Chapter 22, verse 1, let's go with it. And they continued 3 years without war between Syria and Israel. And we're going to see that the covenant that Ahab made with Ben-Hadad is about to become null and void. That was in chapter 20. And it came to pass in the third year that Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, came down to the king of Israel, this being Ahab still. Now, Jehoshaphat, you need to understand, the king of Judah, was a very righteous king. He did right most of the time. The only negative thing that Jehoshaphat did was he entered into It's called an affinity in 2 Chronicles chapter 21, verse 6. That means, if you take it back to the original language, that there was a marriage, and the marriage was between Jehoshaphat's son, Jehoram, and Ahab's daughter, Athaliah. That would be an affinity, an alliance that would cause Jerusalem to run with innocent blood. By a strange sequence of events, you see, Athaliah would become the queen of Judah for some 6 years. Things were not going good in Judah at that time. Verse 3. And the king of Israel said unto his servants, Know ye that Ramoth in Gilead is ours, and we be still, we're silent from taking it, and take it not out of the hand of the king of Syria. Ramoth had been in the tribes of Israel, but the king of Syria took the Ramoth away from Israel. And Jehoshaphat and Ahab had a marital alliance in that their children were married. Now they're about to have a military alliance, an alliance that would almost cost Jehoshaphat his life. Verse 4, And he said unto Jehoshaphat, Ahab to Jehoshaphat, Wilt thou go with me to battle to Ramoth Gilead? And Jehoshaphat said to the king of Israel, I am as thou art, my people as thy people, my horses as thy horses. I'm with you all the way. Judah will be there for you to fight Syria for Ramoth Gilead. Verse 5. And Jehoshaphat said unto the king of Israel, Inquire, I pray thee, at the word of the Lord today. Again, Jehoshaphat, a righteous king, he would think to inquire of the Lord before going to war against the Syrians. Ahab would not have thought to inquire of the Lord. And when we come back in our next lecture, we're going to see how all this turns out. There's going to be a prophet, Micaiah by name. Ahab accused Micaiah of not liking him because Micaiah never prophesied good of him. And that's because Micaiah didn't prophesy out of his own heart, out of his own mind. He prophesied the true word of God. We'll see how it turns out in our next lecture. We got a short message. We'll ask you to listen a moment, won't you please?
Genesis 1:46, the first six chapters in God's Word. The world that was. Did you realize there was a world age before this one? Same old world, different age. The creation itself. When were the races created? You see, all the races were created separately, and you'll find that documented in these particular CDs. How and what was the sin in the garden? It will be discussed in this series also. This is a must for the serious Bible scholar. For if you do not understand how it was in the beginning, you certainly will never understand the end. I think you will find this series very rewarding and certainly will answer questions that no doubt you have always wondered about. Genesis 1:46. Hey, I know you're going to enjoy this series.
Welcome back. We're glad you could join back with us. Let's have the 800 number, please. 800-643-4645. That number good throughout Puerto Rico, the U.S., and Canada. If you have a biblical question that you'd like to pose to possibly be answered on the air, feel free to call that number and leave your question. Please don't ask questions about a specific individual, denomination, or organization by name. We teach God's Word in a positive manner. Throwing out negative about others by name serves no purpose. We simply won't do it. We'll let God's Word do the teaching, the correcting, and the healing. If you're listening by shortwave radio or studying via the internet somewhere around the world that's unable to use that 800 number, Your announcer at the end of the hour will give you our mailing address. Quite all right, to mail your questions in being the point. Got a prayer request? You don't need a telephone number. We can do away with it. You don't need a mailing address. Talk to your Heavenly Father. You know, He's the closest relative that you have. And we learn in Revelation chapter 4, verse 11, why He created you. He created you for His pleasure. And you might say, well, how can I pleasure God? Well, you can pleasure God by not forgetting about Him or ignoring Him, acting like He doesn't exist. He has feelings and emotions just like we do. How do I know? Because we're created in His image. We do have these prayer requests, Father. We come united as one in the name of Your Son, Jesus Christ. We ask You to look upon these, Father. You know their needs, illness, addictions, Father. You know, if it is Your will, a special blessing on each of these. And we also lift up our military troops who are in harm's way around the world, Father. Watch over, guide, direct, touch, heal in Jesus' precious name. Amen and thank You, Father. All right, let's get to some questions and see what's on the mind of folks. First up today, we have Mark in Oklahoma, and Mark asks, do you think we will remember our lives in the flesh when we move to the millennial time? Thank you for your work helping us understand God's Word. Well, you're welcome, Mark. It's a labor of passion, a labor of love, I should say. You know, I think we'll remember more than just what we did in the flesh when we step into our spiritual bodies. I think it's possible we may even remember what happened in the first earth and heaven age. You know, we only utilize about 10% of our intellect in the flesh. I think the flesh gets in the way of our intellect, and when the flesh is no longer in the way of our intellect, I think we're going to have a lot more intelligence about us. Kathleen in Arizona. How do I look up the word Mamzar in the Hebrew section of the Strong's Concordance? Well, first you would have to know what you're saying is a Hebrew word, Mamzar. And to look up a word in the Strong's Concordance, you have to go from the English, which is what the King James Version Bible is. And the word, as it's translated in the Old Testament, in the King James Version Bible, is bastard. And if you look that word up in your concordance, and it will give you all the places in the Bible that appears, references to the scripture, and then tell you the Hebrew Strong's dictionary number to go to. And you'll find that it is the word, Hebrew word Mamzar, which is a child of someone who's of the nation of Israel, and a Gentile, for example. Deborah in Georgia, how do you talk to people about God who don't believe in God? Well, my advice to you would be to plant a seed and then move on. If you see people who don't believe in God, yeah, they need help, probably worse than anyone. But until they get that set of scales off their eyes and blinders off of their eyes and the coverings over their ears, it's going to be hard to get to them. But, you know, harder things have been accomplished. So it's good to try. But again, we're taught in God's Word in Matthew chapter 7, verse 6, not to cast your pearls before swine. That means the seed that you're sowing is precious, but don't waste it on people who just flat don't care about God, and they've told you before that they don't care about God. The only thing they care about is themselves most often. So don't waste your time on them. Don't waste the precious seed. Move on to more fertile ground. Kanisha in Canada, or California, I should say. Why does God allow Satan to exist right now? Well, it's to see whether his children will choose to follow himself, God, in other words, or Satan. You know, those who follow Satan go into the lake of fire right along with Satan. Revelation chapter 20, verse 10, and the following verses, where we have the great white throne judgment. But you see, there was a conflict, a spiritual war. There's still one going on today. But Satan rebelled against God in the first earth and heaven age. At that point in time, one-third of God's children followed Satan. Revelation chapter 12, a parenthetical chapter, covers that. But rather than God destroying one-third of his children, which he did not want to do, we have the second earth and heaven age. And people have that aren't God's elect have free will. And they can choose to follow Satan, or they can choose to follow God. Florence, and I don't know where Florence is from, please give me some clarification on Eve eating an apple in the Garden of Eden. Well, surprise, there is no apple tree in the book of Genesis. What Eve partook of was the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And what was wrong with that? Well, God had commanded Eve and Adam not to partake of that tree. You can partake of any tree in the garden except the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Eve partook of that tree, which is to say the serpent. And I'll give you New Testament scripture that will document what I'm saying. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 3. It states there that Eve was beguiled by the serpent in the garden. And I want you to take your Strong's Concordance and check out that word beguiled. You'll find that it's expateo in the Greek language, which means, and it only has one meaning, is wholly seduced. That's what happened. That's the truth of what happened in the Garden of Eden. The serpent, that's to say Satan, seduced Eve. They had intercourse and she conceived. Genesis chapter 3, verse 16 documents that when the Lord told Eve, I'm going to greatly multiply thy conception. Pamela in Montana. In the millennium, when Jesus comes down for 1,000 years, are we all going to change into spirit form, or just the ones that believe in Jesus? All in the twinkling of an eye, as Paul would put it in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 52, and the following verses turn into spiritual. There will be no more flesh after the second advent begins. You can also read about that in Zechariah chapter 14, the minor prophets. Gene in Michigan, where in the Bible does it say there will be no marriages in heaven? Matthew chapter 22, verse 30. And that's where the scribes and Pharisees come to Jesus and they pose a hypothetical question. And they said this woman was married to a man, and before they had any children, the man died. And so the brother of her husband took her to wife, didn't have any children. It went through five, six, seven of them, I think it was. And they said then, when she dies, which one will she be married to in heaven, in the resurrection is the term they used. And of course, and it was the Sadducees that were asking him this because they didn't believe in life after death. But Jesus told them, you do err and don't understand the power of God, for they neither marry or are given in marriage, but are as the angels in heaven. When you think about it, spiritually speaking, we'll all be married, though. Will be the bride of Christ. Sheena in California, if I do not want to get married, is it a sin to choose a mate to live with but not be married? In biblical times, Sheena, when a man spread his skirt over a woman, that's to say that they had sexual intercourse, he slept with her, they were married. Now, here at the chapel, we encourage, though, people, when children are a possibility, that a legal marital license be obtained. Why? Well, not for the man or the woman's protection, but for the children's protection, that protects the children's rights in the event that the relationship goes down south and negative and it results in a divorce. It protects the children's rights. Vicki in Virginia, can you explain more about the difference between those who will be totally destroyed and those who are lost? Well, Satan and his angels, called the Nephilim in the Hebrew language, the fallen angels, will be totally destroyed in the lake of fire, Revelation chapter 20, verse 10, and the following verses. We still have, we have until the end of the millennium to pull as many of God's children out of the fire as we possibly can. And we're being successful. We've been talking about Elijah in the book of 1 Kings. I believe that this ministry is tied to the Elijah ministry. And what was it that Elijah will do? Well, God promised before that great and terrible day of the Lord, Malachi chapter 4, verses 5 and 6, he said, before that day I will send Elijah to return the hearts of the children back to the fathers, plural. And this ministry is turning the hearts of some of God's children back to the Father with a capital F. We are having success. We intend to pull as many of them out of the fire, meaning the lake of fire, as we possibly can. Diane in Ohio, if one day with the Lord is as 1,000 years, then how long is half an hour here on earth? And I believe you're probably talking about the half hour that there will be silence in heaven, Revelation chapter 8. Verse 1. And to understand that verse, you have to know that the hour of tribulation is the period of time that the Antichrist and his one world political beast will be in power. We learn in Revelation chapter 9 that the hour of temptation is actually a 5-month period. And in that there is silence in heaven for one half of an hour, Satan himself is here de jure on earth as Antichrist for 2.5 months. Ed in South Carolina, thanks for your kind comments. I cannot find the name of Noah's wife in the Bible. Please tell me where I can find her name. Her name is not written in the King James Version Bible, Ed. Rubri, it says R-U-B-R-E, I believe it is, in Nevada. I watched a documentary presented by a pastor with most of the views of Shepherd's Chapel. He was looking into the relationship between Solomon and the Queen of Sheba. He quoted 1 Kings 10:13. Quote, and King Solomon gave unto the Queen of Sheba all her desire, whatever she asked, beside that which Solomon gave her of his royal bounty, end quote. His point was that Solomon and the Queen of Sheba had an intimate relationship that resulted in a son. Seeing that Solomon had so many wives and concubines, what do you think is the possibility of a son with the Queen of Sheba? I don't believe that they had a relationship. You can't document that biblically, and to read that into the verse that you quoted, 1 Kings chapter 10, verse 13, is stretching it to say the least. Solomon was a busy boy. I think, you know, he had, what, 700 wives and 300 concubines, as it's written in 1 Kings chapter 11, verse 3. I don't believe the Queen of Sheba was one of them. I do not believe Solomon had a child with the Queen of Sheba. Vivian in Tennessee, I send money to certain organizations, and about every 2 weeks they send me letters in the mail asking for more money. Is this begging on their part? I certainly consider it begging and browbeating. You know, organizations have people that their job is to increase the amount of donations that are coming in to the organization. And once you send into one, or if you do it twice or three times, they're encouraged. Most of them will sell their mailing list to other organizations. That's one thing that I'm proud to say Shepherd's Chapel never has done and never will do, as long as the current leadership is in place and still in place. We will not sell names, addresses, and telephone numbers of those who study with Shepherd's Chapel. We protect, actually, the mailing list when it's being transported to do a newsletter, for example. We protect the mailing list with our lives. I, too, donate to certain organizations that I think do good works for children or pets even. But what I do is write to them and say, look, I'm going to give one donation a year, or in your case, it might be two donations a year. Please send me a reminder once a year or twice a year, whatever your appetite for giving to that organization is. If they want to continue to receive your donations, they should honor your request and not bombard your mailbox with solicitations. You say they're having to pay postage for those solicitations, and if you tell them I'm only going to respond to once a year, they'll get the message. Mark and Pam in Oklahoma, my question is there a confirmation of knowing if you are of God's 7,000 elect? I know the two witnesses will visit God's elect before the Antichrist comes, but how do you know for sure you're one of God's elect? My husband and I thank you for your study tapes and teachings on television. You're welcome. If you know God's overall plan, if you've studied His Word enough to know His overall plan, and the key, it's an important point you make, that they know, you know, the elect that will be fed and nourished by the two witnesses. The more important than that, though, is that you know that the Antichrist comes before Christ, that you know how to count trumps, and you know that the sixth trump, which is when Satan returns as Antichrist, comes before the seventh trump, which is when Christ returns. So that's pretty good indication that you're one of God's elect. If you haven't obtained the study on elect, I might suggest, Mark and Pam, that you order CD 30417, which is entitled Elect. Stephen in Wisconsin, where in the Bible does it say the 42 months is reduced to 5 months? And of course, the 42 months is the length of time the Antichrist will be in power, 3.5 years. That has been reduced, and the 42 months is mentioned in Revelation chapter 12. We know from Revelation chapter 9, though, that season has been reduced to 5 months in Revelation chapter 9, and it's the season of the locust, which is May through September. Now, does that mean that it's going to be May through September? Not necessarily, but it will be a five-month period. Sterling in Virginia, what verse do you say when you anoint your house? Well, you don't say a verse. There's not one written in the Bible that says, read this verse while you're anointing your home. What you do, first of all, if you have anointing oil, you don't need to do what I'm about to say, but if you don't have anointing oil, you obtain some virgin olive oil. You can obtain that at most any grocery store. I would suggest that you obtain a small vial. Your local pharmacy might be able to sell you a small empty vial. You put a small amount of the oil in the vial, and then in prayer, you ask God to bless the oil, and you tell him, promise him that you'll use it for only anointing purposes, and ask him to bless it. And then you take the vial, put a small amount on your index finger, and you anoint the doorpost of your home, and you order all negative and evil out in the name of Jesus Christ. The last part is the most important, in the name of Jesus Christ. That's where your power is. Susan in South Carolina, and I am out of time, and this is a long question. Susan, I promise you'll be up first in our next lecture. I am out of time. I love you all a great deal. Why? Because you enjoy studying God's Word in depth. And you know what? It makes your Father's day when he looks down from heaven and he sees you with the letter that he wrote to you, the Bible, open, and you're seeking knowledge of him and about him from that letter. It makes his day. Blessings always follow. We are brought to you by your tithes and offerings. If we have helped you, help us keep coming to you and to reach out to others of our brothers and sisters who are lost in this world of darkness. Most important this, though, you stay in his word every day. Every day in your Father's word is a good day, even with trouble. You know why? Jesus is the living word.
Hearing God's word with understanding will change your life. We hope you have enjoyed studying God's Word here on the Shepherd's Chapel Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. If you would like to receive more information concerning Shepherd's Chapel, you may request our free introductory offer. Our introductory offer contains the Mark of the Beast CD, our monthly newsletter with a written Bible study, a CD catalog, and a list of written reference works available through Shepherd's Chapel. To request our free introductory offer by telephone, call 800-643-4645, 24 hours a day. You may also request our introductory offer by writing to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Once again, that's Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. We invite you to join us for the next in-depth Bible study each weekday at the same time. Thank you for watching today's program, and God bless you.
The Book of Deuteronomy. The law was given as our schoolmaster. Have you been to school on God's Word? Certainly one way to go there is to study the book of Deuteronomy. Probably the most exciting thing that Deuteronomy has to offer for you is that great song of Moses, that those that overcome the false Messiah in the end generation will be singing. The law itself being the schoolmaster that keeps us out of trouble in these flesh bodies. Again, an education in taming that part of you that oftentimes needs taming through the old schoolmaster, that great book, Deuteronomy, the law, and its set ways of keeping you from harm's way even in this generation. You're going to enjoy it.
Gravette, Arkansas, this is Shepherd's Chapel with Pastor Arnold Murray. Join with us now as Pastor Murray takes you on a book-by-book, chapter-by-chapter, line-by-line study of God's Word. Now, here is Pastor Murray.
All right. Good day to you. God bless you. Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. We just praise God for the privilege of being able to study His Word with you. You know, man's word sometimes can be reassuring, comforting, but then you've always got to go double check it out in God's word, so why not just stay in the word and have the assurity that you're on the right track? That's the way I feel about it, and that's why we have the format of teaching chapter by chapter and letting